In less than 240 days, the FIFA World Cup will be kicking off here in Qatar, and we are delighted to welcome you to another episode of Living Football. We are in Doha at the 72nd FIFA Congress, a very special one. The first one since the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic that the football world was truly united again physically and not via video anymore. So let's take a look at the highlights of a very exciting week here in Doha.
Guests, friends, volunteers from all over the world, what an emotion it is to be here tonight with you to officially launch the FIFA World Cup Qatar 2022 Volunteers Program. You are the heart, you are the soul, you are the smile of the World Cup. Thanks for being here.
FIFA Football for Schools, it's amazing. It really does make an impact to the country, to the local community.
We want to continue developing football now that we come out of the pandemic. We want to continue engaging tirelessly with all of you day and night, because in the football world, the sun is always shining.
For me, it's a privilege to be the FIFA Museum Ambassador, and our mission is to safeguard, you know, football heritage and culture.
My plea to all of those who have some power in this world, to all of those who are in important political positions in the world, please, please stop conflicts and wars. Please, for our children, for our future.
The whole football world has been gathered together, and also the biggest milestone on the journey to football's flagship event was reached here at the Doha Exhibition and Convention Center. The final draw for the FIFA World Cup. So now fans all over the world, and of course the participating teams, know their possible path to glory.
Football fans, from all over the world, wherever you are, the wait is over. It is time for the final draw of the FIFA World Cup Qatar 2022.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, on all of our viewers around the world, it's now time. Akali, could you remind us of the teams in Pot 1, please?
In Pot 1, hosts Qatar, England, Argentina, France, Spain, Belgium, Brazil, and Portugal.
Right, Lothar, you're the man when it comes to Pot 2.
Netherlands, USA, Mexico, Denmark.
Germany,
Croatia,
Switzerland,
Uruguay.
We expected some magnificent matchups, and we have definitely been spoiled for choice. Now that the draw has been completed, the countdown has truly started to the FIFA World Cup Qatar 2022. Football's greatest showpiece is coming to the Arab world for the first time. It's a very good reason to get excited.
This World Cup will simply be the best World Cup ever.
Are you ready?
With the FIFA World Cup kicking off in November, we also focus on the important progress that has been achieved in the area of workers' welfare and labor rights since the tournament has been awarded to Qatar in 2010, as well as the work that still remains to be done to ensure a lasting social legacy.
When the World Cup was awarded by FIFA to Qatar, we thought there's been no human rights due diligence done here at all.
Wow, how did that happen?
Our immediate reaction is red card for FIFA.
We recognized that the spotlight would be on Qatar, and hence we looked towards entities that provided criticism on the issue or raised the issues of worker welfare in Qatar, which needed improvement. Everybody recognized that it needed improvement.
We immediately dispatched international mission to Qatar to find out what's going on.
I walked those labor camps. They were squalid. They were indeed overcrowded.
The issues of forced labor, payment of recruitment fees, confiscation of passport, health and safety, particularly the issue of heat stress.
We went public and we ran a campaign for nearly seven years until finally in 2016 I said, enough. Nobody cares about this. We took this to the ILO.
The International Trade Union Movement submitted a complaint to the ILO. At the heart of this complaint was allegations that the kafala system was resulting in the exploitation of migrant workers, and that the inspection systems and the complaint systems in the country were not adequately detecting or resolving the concerns of migrant workers.
After 2 or 3 years, we were able to start engaging in a constructive manner. In 2016, BWI signed an agreement with the Supreme Committee on a health and safety inspection.
I think it's worth reflecting what happened in 2016 and some of the changes that happened following that, not least a commitment to human rights is now very firmly enshrined in the FIFA statutes. Secondly, in 2017, the publication of FIFA's human rights policy, which was another big step forward, really laying out our commitment to human rights across the organisation. And then last but not least, the additional requirements that we added to competitions, to the bidding process, to the selection process, and of course to the hosting requirements.
Working hand in hand with the Supreme Committee, strong mechanisms have been put in place in Qatar to enforce heightened standards for FIFA World Cup workers. This included joint inspection on the construction sites, checks on the conditions for construction workers, for example, regarding their recruitment, accommodation, and protections on health and safety. Furthermore, labor rights checks are being conducted on all companies who will deploy workforce on sites during the FIFA World Cup.
After 21 joint inspection with about 36,000 workers, we have seen significant improvement. I can say for now that the health and safety standard in the stadium construction sites are at the same level as the health and safety standards in Europe.
Well, the abolition of kafala, the modern system of slavery, is indeed a remarkable achievement for everybody.
When this law was adopted in October 2020, in that first year of implementation, we saw 240,000 workers change jobs, which really led to labor mobility where there previously wasn't.
The ILO and the ministry with us have indeed negotiated the reports that you can now see. Those reports show a massive decline in the risk of loss of life. Qatar now has a law around heat stress. If every other country had one, I'd be really delighted.
The work that has been done by Qatar has been incredible in the last few years. These seismic changes, which have been put in place, protect hundreds of thousands of workers with the abolishment of the kafala system, with the introduction of minimum wages, with protection measures for the heat, putting workers in Qatar in a similar position to workers anywhere else in the world, in the Western world.
We've been working with FIFA on looking at LGBTIQ rights in Qatar in the run-up to the World Cup. But this potentially was a risk factor for the tournament, and there was no work being done to address it. So we've written to FIFA, written to the Supreme Committee, and had an engagement with both of them in order to make sure that the questions that the community have, that their questions are answered, that they feel safe.
We are pleased to be working with a group of LGBT plus organisations from around the world. FIFA is very clear with all our hosts. Our tournaments are welcome and inclusive to everybody.
Qatar is a hospitable country, and we will ensure that everybody who comes to the state of Qatar, who comes to the World Cup, will enjoy a safe environment and one in which not only will they be able to enjoy the football, but for me personally, more importantly, they'll be able to build bonds with people from different backgrounds. And hopefully these bonds will be long-lasting.
So for me, there is no doubt that FIFA is working its best to comply with the human rights due diligence. But before the World Cup play its final game, I think it's important that the government comes up with a strong enforcement mechanism where workers' voices are heard, where workers' voices are addressed through the Migrant Worker Center.
I think we're on the right path. I think there's a lot of work to be done, but that's positive. There's nothing here that we are doing that is not going to be seen in future generations as the right thing to do and as the thing that made our sport even better.
This is the opportunity for us to really be able to create human-to-human bonds, recognize that we have differences, but recognize also that we share one thing, which is our common humanity.
Work still remains to be done, but Qatar is truly looking forward to welcoming the world. It's going to be a unique World Cup, the first World Cup in the Middle East. A compact one, fans will be able to watch more than one game a day, and it's a big opportunity for building bridges. And now we are delighted to introduce to you one of the key players in preparing Qatar for the FIFA World Cup, Fatma Al Nuaimi, Executive Director at the Supreme Committee for Delivery and Legacy. We had the chance to meet her at the FIFA Congress.
Actually, I feel like the draw that happened this weekend is like one of the biggest milestones. I mean, having over 2,000 guests coming, all the qualifying nations, a lot of media, MRLs in town, broadcasters. So it was actually a really big moment because we're getting closer of shaping up the tournament. Stadium opening inauguration, also like a very emotional moment. I mean, like working from the legacy plans of these projects, seeing it coming to life, and then later on inaugurating it. It's actually as well like a very proud moment for us. I mean, speaking as a Qatari and as someone who's working on the project. The power of football, it's not just more than 1 month of a tournament, but actually it would help in changing and transform perception. I mean, like when it comes to our part of the world, it always has been misunderstood or it's always been negatively reported. But I mean, like that's the opportunity for a lot of fans and a lot of people coming to this part of the world and to have a first-hand experience. Because I mean, like with this opportunity, you get to know people, people to people, to learn more about a new culture, to learn about a new new traditions, and I think this is what actually makes every World Cup unique. When it's hosted in that nation, people actually get the chance to introduce to a new atmosphere, a new culture. Actually, we have three ministers who are women. We do have different leading or women in leadership positions in politics and sports and oil and gas, banking sector. So there is a wider spectrum, and I think with this tournament and the light that the World Cup have, it's actually going to shed the light of the opportunities and the leadership of women that actually are taking forward in developing this country. So one of the actually legacy programs that we have, Generation Amazing, which started since the bid in 2009. Today we actually have reached 725,000 beneficiaries. And the program is about using, it's the CSR flagship of the Supreme Committee, and it's using the power of sport to drive social change. And we actually have, we're operating more than 10 countries with having an educational program, as well as building football pitches in these countries. I mean, like to name a few, like Nepal, Pakistan, India. We also have like in Jordan and other countries.
At the start of the Congress week, the FIFA Foundation signed two memorandums of understanding. So the Football for School program is now working alongside Generation Amazing and the Qatar Foundation. In the future, the event was held only a short distance away from Lusail Stadium, the venue at which the FIFA World Cup final will take place on December 18th. Joining more than 80 school children were three FIFA World Cup stars, FIFA World Cup winner Youri, Djorkaeff, alongside Australia's Tim Cahill and Netherlands' Nigel de Jong.
Football for School is the biggest project for FIFA Foundation, you know. And to explain it with short words, you have two very important words in our programs: school, football, football, school. We combine two things very important for the society: education and sport. Through sport, you gain some confidence, some trust, some united, some defeat sometimes, victory. We're strong in the society, and education, of course, you can apply all what you train and learn on the field to do it in the life. And I think it's why we are so proud to be today in Qatar, where we know this country is opening through football, through the FIFA World Cup, to a different level.
Look, I think it's amazing. FIFA Football for Schools, firstly, I was there in Lebanon when we launched the first ever program, which was incredible because it really does make an impact to the country, to the local community. And now with Qatar Foundation, Generation Amazing, all the work that we've been doing for the last 2 years domestically, it's been a privilege because it's about keeping kids active, boys and girls, grassroots programs, education. And this is another conduit towards that platform. And to have everyone here, Youri, Djorkaeff, everyone involved, especially at a special time with the World Cup draw coming up, it's exciting, and it's in Qatar. The biggest show on earth is going to be here, and everyone's, you know, trying their hardest to make it an unbelievable experience for the World Cup, but also for countries all around the world.
I mean, you know, the look up office to former football players, I think that's very important, but they can also see that you're just a normal person, just as humble as they are. We all started, you know, from a humble beginning, so we all started like how they did, so that's also something that they look up to. So if they have any questions regarding football, but also how to become a better human, I think that's the main target from days like this.
I think the greatest thing with FIFA as well, they have the app to support it, not only for the players, but also for the coaches. So when we go around the world and we get to implement these the apps and the platforms, it educates the teachers, which educates the students, and just have fun. And that's what it's all about. And like I said, it's an absolute pleasure to be down here in one of the training centres that's going to be for the World Cup 2022 in Lusail. And the kids even get a little flavour of what a World Cup's going to feel like.
We built an app where you can reach all the sessions, football sessions that is possible. We built more than 300 sessions, but not just, you know, easy for us to take it from the FIFA and to put inside with all the explanation. Now we did some video where tomorrow teacher will never play football, he can teach it, the base of football.
This project is only one of many. In our forthcoming episode, we will showcase you one of the myriad projects that FIFA and the FIFA Foundation are supporting, developing and funding all over the world. It's already time we are closing this episode of Living Football with the most important people in football. Of course, the fans, their enthusiasm is the essence of football. And the FIFA fan movement gives a voice to fans all over the world. So we are going to say goodbye from Doha with you, the best fans in the world, and we will see you next time back again at the home of FIFA in Zurich, Switzerland. So have a good time till then. Goodbye.